This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truths of Jesus Christ's name.
Christian died, suffering at the hands of Rome, cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be loved by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
So, hello, my dear brethren, and we are here today with Jogler 66 from Hour of the Truth to read the next part of the book that I have recently started reading, next to all the other things that I'm doing. As you can see here, very little in the picture, the history of the Inquisition from Philip from Limborch, a Dutchman who wrote this book in 1692, and that was translated into English and published in English in 1731 by Samuel Chandler. And what have we seen so far? Well, we are still busy in the introduction, and now we are reading in section 2, called Of the Persecutions Amongst Christians Upon Account of Religion. So we first dealt with the persecutions from the heathen among the religion, but we saw also that in the heathens were mixed already Christians and Jews, of course. Because what is heathen? Well, I think it is heathen from the standpoint of the Roman Catholic Church, of course. Yeah. So this one is called now Of the Persecutions Amongst Christians Upon Account of Religion. If any person was to judge of the nature and spirit of the Christian religion by the spirit of conduct only of too many who have professed to believe in it in all nations and almost throughout all ages of the Christian Church, he could scarce fail to censure it as an institution unworthy of the God of order and peace, subversive of the welfare and happiness of societies, and designed to enrich and aggrandize a few only, at the expense of the liberty, reason, consciousness, substance, and lives of others. For what confusions and calamities, what ruins and desolations, what rapines and murders, have been introduced into the world under the pretended authority of Jesus Christ and supporting and propagating Christianity. Here the author is exactly telling us what is happening to the time when Roman Catholicism took over Christianity, and everything that Roman Catholicism does is done in the name of Christianity, and by that, of course, it gives Christianity a bad name. So, what is the best part of our ecclesiastical history better than a history of the pride and ambition, the avarice and tyranny, the treachery and cruelty of Rome, and of the persecutions and dreadful miseries of others? And what could an unprejudiced person acquainted with this melancholy truth, and who had never seen the sacred records, nor informed himself from thence of the genuine nature of Christianity, think but that it was one of the worst religions in the world, as tending to destroy all the natural sentiments of humanity and compassion, and inspiring its votaries with that wisdom which is from beneath, and which is earthly, sensual, and devilish. If this charge could be justly fixed upon the religion of Christ, it would be unworthy the regard of every wise and good man, and render it both the interest and duty of every nation in the world to reject it. It must be allowed by all who know anything of the progress of the Christian religion that the first preachers and propagators of it used none of these vile methods to support and spread it. Both their doctrines and lives destroy every suspicion of this nature. And yet, in their times, the beginnings of this spirit appeared. And we can read right away here where in the Bible this spirit appeared. And I'm going to tell you that it even appeared before what is called here, because we are reading from 3 John 1, when we look into who was Diotrephes. It was already in the book of Acts, when we were introduced into Simon the sorcerer. And you have a very interesting work that I'm going to read online also, which is Simon Peter versus Simon the sorcerer, Simon Magus. And there already we see this beginnings of this spirit, of this devilish spirit, of this satanic spirit that enters into the church. Because the founder of the quote-unquote Christian church in Rome was not Peter, who was never in Rome, not Peter the Apostle, not Cephas, no, it was Simon the sorcerer, Simon Magus. Yeah? And that already was the spirit that appeared at that time. But here in this book we read about Diotrephes, and Diotrephes is loved the preeminence, the author says here. And Diotrephes is someone that we get to know when we look into the Bible in 3 John chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, that I'm going to read to you right here. It says, I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth us not. Wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words. And not content therewith, neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and casteth them out of the church. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God. And Diotrephes is someone who has not seen God. He loved preeminence, and therefore would not own and receive the inspired apostle. We also read that there were great divisions and schisms in the church of Corinth, and that many grievous disorders were caused therein, by their ranking themselves under different leaders and heads of parties, one being for Paul, another for Apollos, and another for Cephas. These animosities were difficulty healed by the apostolic authority. These animosities were difficultly healed difficultly healed by the apostolic authority, but do not, however, appear to have broken out into mutual hatreds to the open disgrace of the Christian name and procession. The primitive Christians seem for many years generally to have maintained the warmest affection for each other, and have distinguished themselves by their mutual love, the great characteristic of the disciples of Christ. The Gospels and the Epistles of the Apostles all breathe with this amiable spirit, and abound with exhortations to cultivate this godlike disposition. It is reported of Saint John, that in his extreme old age at Ephesus, being carried into the church by the disciples upon account of his weakness, he used to say nothing else every time he was brought there but this remarkable sentence, Filioli diligiti altu terum, meaning, little children, love one another. And when some of the brethren were tired of hearing so often the same thing and asked him, Sir, why do you always repeat the sentence? He answered with a spirit worthy an apostle, This is the command of the Lord, and the fulfilling of the law. Precepts of this kind, so frequently inculcated, could not but have a very good influence in keeping alive the spirit of charity and mutual love. And indeed, the primitive Christians were so very remarkable for this temper that they were taken notice of on this very account, and recommended even by their enemies as patterns of beneficence and kindness. But at length, in the second century, the spirit of pride and domination appeared publicly. The spirit of pride. We can also say the spirit of Satan. And he is the dragon, and he gives the beast its power. In the second century, the spirit of pride and domination appeared publicly and created great disorders and schisms amongst Christians. There had been a controversy of some standing on what day Easter should be celebrated. The Asiatic Church thought that it ought to be kept on the same day on which the Jews held the Passover, the 14th day of Nisan, their first month, on whatsoever day of the week it should fall out. Now, this is quite interesting, right? And we could easily fall into the trap on going into a discussion here, but we are not that easy to deceive, right? The author says, there had been a controversy of some standing on what day Easter should be celebrated. The Asiatic churches thought that it ought to be kept on the same day on which the Jews held the Passover, the 14th day of the Nisan, their first month, on whatever day in the week it shall fall out. You should never practice the quote-unquote Easter holiday, the Easter feast, because Easter goes back to Astarte, Ishtar, the Queen of Heaven, and Ishtar, which is actually pronounced at Easter. It is pagan to the core. So when the Asiatic churches, it reads here, thought that it ought to be kept on the same day on which the Jews held the Passover, that is of course more correctly, but still then you do not celebrate Easter. If anything, you celebrate the death of Christ that happened on that day, right? And you give communion to each other, right? You break bread, not the communion of the Roman Catholic Church. Don't understand me wrong. What they do in the Eucharist, no. But breaking bread together and having wine together in remembrance of Jesus Christ. That you can do, in my opinion, on the same day the Jews held the Passover, the 14th day of Nisan, the first month, on whatever day of the week it should fall out. Never ever even get to the idea to celebrate Easter. Easter is pagan to the core. Now anyway, the author continues here, the custom the custom of other churches was different, who kept the festival of Easter only on that Lord's Day, which was next after the 14th of the moon. This controversy appears at first view to be of no matter of importance, as there is no command in sacred writings to keep this festival at all, much less specifying the particular day on which it should be celebrated. This is the important stuff. Yeah? There is no command in the sacred writings, the Holy Bible, the Holy Book, the inspired Word of God, to keep this festival at all. No, there is not, there will never be, and there was never. So when they are falling into a discussion about when to hold this demonic, satanic feast of Easter, they are always wrong, because that is not commanded in the sacred writings anywhere. Now Eusebius, the author continues, tells us from Irenaeus that Polycarp, bishop of Smyrna, came to Anicetus, bishop of Rome, on account of this very controversy, and that though they differed from one another in this and some other things, some other lesser things even, yet they embraced one another with a kiss of peace. Polycarp neither persuading Anicetus to conform to his custom, nor Anicetus breaking off communion with Polycarp for not complying with his. This was a spirit of conduct worthy these Christian bishops. But Victor the Roman prelate acted a more haughty and violent part. For after he had received the letters of the Asiatic bishops, giving their reasons for their own practice, he immediately excommunicated all the churches of Asia and those of neighboring provinces for heterodoxy. And by his letters, declared all the brethren unworthy of communion. This conduct was greatly displeasing to some other of the bishops, who exhorted him to mind the things that made for peace, unity, and Christian love. Irenaeus especially, in the name of all his brethren, the bishops of France, blamed him for thus censuring whole churches of Christ, and puts him in mind of the peaceable spirit of several of his predecessors, who did not break off communion with their brethren upon account of such lesser differences as these. Indeed, this action of Pope Victor was a very insolent abuse of excommunication, and is an abundant proof that the simplicity of the Christian faith was greatly departed from, and that heterodoxy and orthodoxy were made to depend on conformity or non-conformity to the modes of circumstances of certain things, when there was no shadow of any order for the things themselves in the sacred writings, and that the lust of power and the spirit of pride had too much possessed some of the bishops in the Christian church, in the quote-unquote Christian church, because the beginning of paganism is already to see here. The same Victor also excommunicated one Theodosius for being unsound in the doctrine of the Trinity. And the doctrine of the Trinity is a pagan doctrine. The doctrine of the Trinity is a Babylonian-rooted tradition of the Roman Catholic Church. And already here it started. We are only speaking about the 2nd century, right? Means the years 100 to 200 after Jesus' crucifixion. So early it came in there. You can almost say the moment the apostles were gone, the apostasy came into the church. The moment the people did not live anymore, who saw and lived with Jesus Christ, at that moment already the church began to fall into apostasy. Especially when we read here that this quote-unquote Pope Victor also excommunicated Theodosius for being unsound in the doctrine of the Trinity. So I understand from this that Theodosius, being unsound in the doctrine of the Trinity, probably rejected the Trinity, which is pure apostolic Christianity. But let's see what the author further has to say. 'Tis no wonder that after this he should find matters growing worse and worse. As the primitive Christians had any intervals from persecution, they became more profligate in their morals and more quarrelsome in their tempers. As the revenues of the several bishops increased, they grew more ambitious, less capable of contradiction, more haughty and arrogant in their behavior, more envious and revengeful in every part of their conduct, and more regardless of the simplicity and gravity of their procession and character, of their profession and character. The accounts I have before given, of them from Cyprian and Eusebius, before the Diocletian persecution, to which I might add the later one of Saint Jerome, are very melancholy and affecting, and show how fastly they were degenerated from the piety and peaceable spirit of many of their predecessors, and how ready they were to enter into the worst measures of persecution, could they but have got the opportunity and power. Now under Constantine, now we are speaking all of a sudden already of the 4th century, the 300s. Under Constantine the Emperor, when they were restored to full liberty, their churches rebuilt and their imperial edicts everywhere published in their favor, they immediately began to discover what spirit they were of. As soon as ever they had the temptations of honor and large revenues before them. Constantine's letters are full proof of the jealousies and animosities that reigned amongst them. In his letter to Miltiades, Bishop of Rome, he tells him that he had been informed that Cassilianus, Bishop of Carthage, had been accused of many crimes of some by some of his colleagues, bishops of Africa, and that it was very grievous to him to see so great a number of people divided into parties, and the bishops disagreeing amongst themselves. Now I have to add here a little bit to something that we've just read, because we are reading about Carthage. In his letter to Miltiades, Bishop of Rome, he tells him that he had been informed that Cassilianus, Bishop of Carthage, had been accused of many crimes by some of his colleagues, bishops of Africa, and that it was very grievous for him to see that a great number of people divided into parties and the bishops disagreeing amongst themselves. So, Carthage, that is the capital of the land where the Vandals lived. And you, as a Bible-believing Christian who has already studied the Antichrist, knows that, for example, from my videos, the characteristics of Antichrist already, that when the Roman pagan empire fell into 10 different kingdoms, 3 had to be plucked up by the roots. And those were the Ostrogoths, the Heruli, and the Vandals. And the Vandals had as capital Carthage. And Carthage, you also know from many Roman Caesars who again and again and again attacked Carthage. And they even played that war later in the Circus Maximus, where today, of course, St. Peter's Basilica and the Vatican is seated. That's on the place where Circus Maximus was at that time. But I find this quite interesting, because here comes for the first time the mentioning of the Bishop of Carthage. And we know that that nation of Carthage, the Vandals, had been completely rooted out by the Roman pagan, by the pagan Roman Empire, just before the Caesars fell, and then the little horn, the Bishop of Rome, the son of perdition, the man of sin, the Antichrist, took over. But let's continue. And though the emperor was willing to reconcile than by a friendly reference to the controversy to Miltiades and others, yet in spite of all his endeavors, they maintained their quarrels and factious opposition to each other, and through secret grudges and hatred would not acquiesce the sentence of those he had appointed to determine the affair. So that as he has complained to Crestus, bishop of Syracuse, those who ought to have maintained a brotherly affection and peaceable disposition toward one each other, did in scandalous and detestable manner separate from one another and gave occasion to the common enemies of Christianity to deride and scoff at them. For this reason he summoned a council to meet at Arles in France, that after an impartial hearing of the several parties, the controversy which had been carried on for a long while in a very intemperate manner might be brought to a friendly and Christian compromise. Eusebius further adds that he not only called together councils in the several provinces upon account of the quarrels that arose amongst the bishops, but that he himself was present in them, and did all he could to promote peace amongst them. However, all he could do had but little effect, and it must be owned that he himself greatly contributed to prevent it, by his large endowment of churches, by the riches and honors which he conferred on the bishops, and especially by his authorizing them to fit as judges upon the consciences and faith of others, by which he confirmed them in a worldly spirit, the spirit of domination, ambition, pride, and avarice, which hath in all ages proved fatal to the peace and true interest of the Christian Church. A very long sentence. As you know already, this book is full of long sentences. I have to read this once again to make you really understand what he says here. It is, how about the spirit of domination, ambition, pride, and avarice sloped into the hearts of the people of the Christian Church. We read, however, all he could do, that is Eusebius, even though that he seemed to be of good mind at first, all he could do had but little effect. And it must be owned that he himself greatly contributed to prevent it. So all he could do had but little effect. And it must be owned that he himself had greatly contributed to prevent it. By his large endowment of churches, by the riches and honors which he conferred on the bishops, and especially by his authorizing them to fit as judges upon the consciences and faith of others. Where do we know that spirit from? To be the judge upon the consciences and faith of others? That is the spirit of Antichrist. That is exactly what the Pope is today. He is the judge of all men and not to be judged by men. And he is the conscience and faith holder of everybody else. That's at least what the Pope claims. This is the same spirit coming out here from Eusebius already in the 4th century. Huh? As I've just read, by which he confirmed them in a worldly spirit, not in a spiritual way, where the kingdom of Christ is in heaven, not a heavenly spirit, but a worldly spirit, the spirit of domination, the spirit of ambition, the spirit of pride and avarice, which hath in all ages proved fatal to the peace and true interest of the Christian Church. A Christian Church cannot prosper where the spirit is worldly, where the spirit of domination, ambition, pride, and avarice rules sovereign, rules supreme. There Christianity cannot prosper. That's why Christianity had no chance in these circumstances subscribed here by Eusebius. In the first edict given us at large by Eusebius, published in favor of the Christians, he acted the part of a wise, good, and impartial governor, in which, without mentioning any particular sects, he gave full liberty to all Christians, and to all other persons whatsoever, of following that religion which they ought best, which they thought best. This is a prime example of religious freedom. That is to infiltrate the Christian church with the pagan church. Read it again if you don't understand it. It says here, he acted the part of a wise, good, and impartial governor, in which, without mentioning any particular sects, meaning Christians also, he gave full liberty to all Christians and to all other persons, meaning all other religions, whatsoever, of following that religion which they thought best. That is religious freedom. That is not what Christ taught, is it? Anyway, this liberty was of no long duration, and soon abridged in reference both to the Christians and heathens. For although in this first mentioned edict he orders the churches and effects of the Christians in general to be restored to them, yet in one immediately following he confines this grant to the Catholic Church. Yeah, I hope that you understand it. For although in his first mentioned edict he orders the churches and effects of Christians in general to be restored to them, yet in one immediately following he confines this grant to the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church grants freedom of religion only, meaning the freedom to venerate her own religion, Roman Catholicism. Now, after this, in a letter to Miltiades, Bishop of Rome, complaining of the differences fomented by the African bishops, he lets him know that he had so great a reverence for the Catholic Church that he would not have him suffer in any place any schism or difference whatsoever. In another to Caecilianus, Bishop of Carthage, after giving him to understand that he had ordered Ursus to pay his reverence 3,000 pieces, and Heraclides to disperse to him whatever other sums his reverence should have occasion for, he orders him to complain of all persons who should go on to corrupt the people of the most holy Catholic Church by any evil and false doctrine, to Anulinus, the proconsul, and Patricius, to whom he had given instructions on this affair, that if they persevered in such madness, they might be punished according to his orders. 'Tis easy to guess what the Catholic faith and church meant, that which was approved by the bishops who had the greatest interest in his favor. Now, here the author says a sentence that is absolutely 100% as valid today as it was almost 2,000 years ago. 'Tis easy to guess what the Catholic faith and church meant, that which was approved by the bishops who had the greatest interest in his favor. And of course, with the Roman Catholic Church as it exists today, we are speaking of the Bishop of Bishops, the Pope. It had to be of the greatest interest in his favor. The bishop's favor, the bishop of bishops' favor, the pope's favor. Now, as to the heathens, soon after the settlement of the whole empire under his government, he sent into all the provinces Christian presidents, forbidding them and all other officers of superior dignity to sacrifice, and confining so much of them as were Christians in the honors due to their characters and stations, hereby endeavoring to support the kingdom of Christ, which is not of this world, by motives purely worldly, the prospects of temporal preferments and honors. And notwithstanding the excellent law he had before published, that every one should have free exercise of his own religion, and worship such gods as they thought proper, he soon after prohibited the old religion, meaning the worship of idols in cities and country, commanding that no statues of the god should be erected or any sacrifices offered upon their altars. And yet, notwithstanding this abridgment of the liberty of religion, he declares in his letters afterwards, written to all the several governors of his provinces, that though he wished the ceremonies of the temples and the power of darkness were wholly removed, he would force none, but that every one should have the liberty of acting in religion as he pleased. That is typical doublespeak as we know it today also. You know? On the one hand, they forbid it, and on the other hand, they leave it. They had to leave it, you know, because otherwise the heathens would have rebelled. They were all pagans in Rome. They had to be made Christians step by step. And how did they do that? By putting into quote-unquote Christianity, or let's better say into Roman Catholicism, all their heathen rituals and deities and saints, and give them Christian names. That's what we're going to see how further we come into this book, and what you've already learned from other book readings of mine, where you know how the Roman Catholic Church infiltrated the Christianity, of course. But here it says, on the one hand, that he makes a law that no other, that all the heathen gods shall not be worshipped anymore. And on the other hand, he says, for he would force none, but that everyone should have the liberty of acting in religion as he pleased. So on the one hand it's forbidden, and on the other hand, well, you can do whatever you think is right, whatever pleases you, whatever pleases your religion. The author continues here, 'tis not to be wondered at that the persons who advised these edicts to suppress the ancient religion of the heathens should be against tolerating any other amongst themselves, who should presume to differ from them in articles of the Christian religion they had espoused. Because if erroneous and false opinions in religion as such are to be prohibited or punished by the civil power, there's equal reason for persecuting a Christian whose belief is wrong and whose practice is erroneous as for persecuting persons that are other false religion whatever, and the same temper and principles that lead to the latter will also lead to justify the former. And as the civil magistrate, under the direction of his priests, must always judge for himself what is truth and error in religion, his laws for supporting the one and punishing the other must always be in consequence of his judgment. And therefore, if Constantine and his bishops were right in prohibiting heathenism by civil laws, because they believed it erroneous and false, Diocletian and Licinius and their priests were equally right in prohibiting Christianity by civil laws, because they believed it not only erroneous and false, but the highest impiety and blasphemy against their heathen gods, and even a proof of atheism itself. And by the same rule, every Christian that hath power is in the right to persecute his Christian brother whenever he believes him to be in the wrong. And in truth, they seem generally to have acted upon this principle, for which party soever of them could get uppermost was against the toleration and liberty for those who differed from them, and endeavored by all methods to oppress and destroy them. Every Christian that hath power is in the right to persecute his Christian brother. Where is that written in the Bible that I am to persecute my Christian brother? It says here, whenever he believes him to be in the wrong. Are we to persecute each other because of our belief? I don't think so. I think that we Christians are called to call out false doctrines and point at them, but the judgment is of God and not of us. And here you see already the foundations being built on the coming Inquisition. Every Christian that hath power is in the right to persecute his Christian brother. So when the one Christian brother thinks that the other Christian brother has something wrong in his belief, he can persecute him. This opens up the door wide for the coming Inquisition, what this whole book is all about. This is why we are reading this in the introduction, that you understand that spirit of Satan, that spirit of the Antichrist that came slouching into the early church at the time of Constantine here. And that those rules were made. That it was the same rule for every Christian that hath power. He has the absolute right to persecute his Christian brother whenever he believes him to be in the wrong. Roman Catholics have the right to persecute Bible-believing true Christians because they think our beliefs are wrong. And that's exactly what Jesus warned us about, right? He said that they will persecute you and they will think they do God a service. That's what Jesus said already. And the foundations of that is what you see right here in the time of Constantine. I cannot repeat the sentence often enough that you understand it. Every Christian that hath power is in the right to persecute his Christian brother whenever he believes him to be in the wrong. This is put into civil laws that we can read here. Yeah? That comes from. Those are the same civil laws that we have today. And because the civil laws that we have in our society today are subservient to the Roman Catholic canon law. And here you have it again. Every Christian that hath power is in the right to persecute his Christian brother whenever he believes him to be in the wrong. There's nothing Christian about in this sentence. But let's continue. And in truth, they seem generally to have acted upon this principle all through the ages. For which party soever of them could get uppermost was against all toleration and liberty of those who differed from them, and endeavored by all methods to oppress and destroy them. I think you got the gist of what I was just reading, right? The sentiments of the primitive Christians, at least for near three centuries, in reference to the deity of our Lord Jesus Christ, were generally speaking pretty uniform. Nor do there appear to have been any public quarrels about this article of the Christian faith. Some few persons, indeed, differed from the commonly received opinion. One Theodotus, a tenor, under the reign of Commodus, asserted Christ was a mere man, and on his account was excommunicated with other of his followers by Pope Victor, who appears to have been very liberal in his censures against others. Artemon propagated the same erroneous opinion under Severus. Beryllus, also an Arabian bishop under Guardian, taught that our Savior had no proper personal substance, I guess you should call this word, before his becoming man, nor any proper Godhead of his own, but only the Father's Godhead residing in him. But afterwards, his opinion, being convinced on his error by the arguments of Origen. Origen was also a Roman Catholic teacher, not a Christian teacher. Sabellius also propagated much the same doctrine, denying also the real personality of the Holy Ghost. After him, Paulus Samosetanus, bishop of Antioch, and many of his clergy publicly avowed the same principles concerning Christ and were excommunicated by a large council of bishops. But though these excommunications upon account of differences in opinion prove that the bishops had set up for judges of the faith and assumed a power of dominion over the conferences or consciences of others, yet as they had no civil effects and were not enforced by any penal laws, they were not attended with the public confusions to the open reproach of the Christian Church. But when once Christianity was settled by the laws of the empire, interesting sentence, if you don't pay attention, you just read over it. But when once Christianity was settled by the laws of the empire, no, Christianity has its own laws, the laws of God, not the laws of an empire, not the laws of a worldly kingdom. There's the big mistake. So when Christianity was settled by the laws of the empire, that means when Christianity capitulated. Once Christianity was settled by the laws of the empire and the bishops free to act as they pleased without any fear of public enemies to disturb and oppress them, they fell into more shameful and violent quarrels upon account of their differences concerning the nature and dignity of Christ. Let me tell you right here, they all denied Christ. They worship another Christ. The controversy first began with Alexander, Bishop of Alexandria, and Arius, one of his presbyters, and soon spread itself into other churches, inflaming bishop against bishop, who out of pretense of support of divine truth excited tumults and entertained irreconcilable hatreds toward one another. These divisions of the prelates set the Christian people together by the ears, as they happened to savor their different leaders and heads of parties. And the dispute was managed with such violence that it soon reached the whole Christian world and gave occasion to the heathens in several places to ridicule the Christian religion upon their public theatres. How different were these tempers of the bishops of clergy of these times from the excellent spirit of Dionysius, bishop of Alexandria in the reign of Decius, who writing to Novatus upon account of disturbance he had raised in the Church of Rome, but the severity of his doctrine in not admitting those who lapsed into idolatry in times of persecution evermore to communion, though they gave all the marks of true repentance and conversion, tells him, quote, One ought to suffer anything in the world rather than divide the Church of God. Unquote. The occasion of the Arian controversy was this. Alexander, Bishop of Alexandria, speaking in a very warm manner concerning the Trinity before the presbyters and clergy of his church, affirmed there was an unity in the Trinity, and particularly that the Son was co-eternal and co-substantial, and of the same dignity with the Father. Arius, one of his presbyters, thought that he, bishop, by his doctrine, was introducing the Sabellian heresy, and therefore opposed him, arguing in this manner, quote, "If the Father begot the Son, he who was begotten must have a beginning of his existence. And from hence, says he, 'tis manifested that there was a time when he was not. The necessary consequence of which he affirmed was this, that he had his subsistence out of things not existing." Sozomen adds further that he asserted, quote, "that by virtue of his free will the Son was capable of vice as well as virtue, and that he was the mere creature and work of God," unquote. The bishop, being greatly disturbed by these expressions of Arius upon account of the novelty of them, and not able to bear such an opposition from one of his presbyters to his own principles, commanded Arius to forbear the use of them and to embrace the doctrine of consubstantiality and co-eternity with the Father and the Son. But Arius was not thus to be convinced, especially as a great number of the bishops and clergy were of his opinion and supported him, and for this reason himself and the clergy of his party were excommunicated and expelled the church in a council of near 100 of the Egyptian and Libyan bishops met together for that purpose by the bishop who in this case was both party and judge, the enemy and condemner of Arius. Well, you know, Arius, that is also where we got Arianism from, right? So, man-centered gospel, right? So I hope you understand that while I'm reading this to you. Upon this treatment, Arius and his friends sent circular letters to the several bishops of the church, giving them an account of their faith and desiring that if they found their sentiments orthodox, they would write to Alexander in their favor. If they judged them wrong, they would give them instructions how to believe. Thus was the dispute carried into the Christian church, and the bishops being divided in their opinions, some of them wrote to Alexander not to admit Arius and his party into communion without renouncing their principles, whilst others of them persuaded them to act in a different part. The bishop not only followed the advice of the former, but wrote letters to the several bishops not to communicate with any of them, nor to receive them if they should come to them, nor to credit Eusebius, nor any other person that would write to them on their behalf, but to avoid them as the enemies of God and the corruptors of the souls of men. And not so much as for salute them, or to have any communion with them in their crimes. Eusebius, who was bishop of Nicomedia, sent several letters to Alexander, exhorting him to let the controversy peaceably drop and to receive Arius into communion. But finding by the same rule every Christian that hath power is in the right... what is this here? I'm sorry. I lost a page here. I have to see where I am. Just a second here. So I'm gonna read the sentence again because I came page too high on this PDF. I'm sorry for that. Eusebius, who was bishop of Nicomedia, sent several letters to Alexander, exhorting him to let the controversy peaceably drop and to receive Arius into communion. But finding him inflexible to all his repeated entreaties, he got a synod to meet in Bithynia, from whence they wrote letters to the other bishops to engage them to receive the Arians to their communion and to persuade Alexander to do the same. But all their endeavors proved ineffectual, and by these unfriendly dealings the parties grew more enraged against each other, and the quarrel became incurable. This, I confess, not a little surprising that the whole Christian world should be put into such a flame upon account of the dispute of so abstruse and metaphysical a nature, as this really was in the curse of men and management of it. Alexander's doctrine, as Arius represents it in his letter to Eusebius of Nicodemia, was this, quote, God is always, and the Son always. The same time the Father, the same time the Son. The Son coexists with God unbegottenly, being ever begotten, being unbegottenly begotten. That God was not before the Son, no, not in conception, or the least point of time, or being ever God, ever a Son, for the Son is out of God himself. Unquote. Nothing could be more inexcusable than the tearing the churches in pieces upon account of such high and futile and subtle points as these, except the conduct of Arius, who on the other hand asserted that, as Alexander, his bishop, in his letter to the bishop of Constantinople tells us, quote, that there was a time when there was no Son of God, that he who before was not, afterwards existed, being made, whensoever he was made, just as any man whatsoever, and that therefore he was of a mutual nature, and equally receptive of vice and virtue, and other things of the like kind. Unquote. If these were the things taught, and publicly avowed by Alexander and Arius, as each reference the other's principles, I persuade myself that every sober man will think they both deserved censure. From thus leaving the plain account of Scripture, introducing terms of their own invention into a doctrine of pure revelation, and at last censuring and writing one against another, and dividing the whole Church of Christ upon account of them. A house divided in itself cannot stand, right? And you see the division already here. And you see, of course, the apostasy already here. These writings from the different bishops, from Constantinople, from the bishop from Alexandria, their different way of thinking of the quote-unquote Godhead, a word that doesn't even appear in the Bible, their own personal interpretation of what Jesus was and what Jesus was not, influenced, of course, by Arianism, the man-centered gospel, all this led, of course, to the big apostasy of the real Christianity, meaning the Christianity of the apostles. But it's no uncommon thing, the author continues, for warm disputants to mistake and misrepresent each other. And that this was the case in the present controversy is, I think, evident beyond dispute. Alexander and Arius, describing each other's opinions not as they held them themselves, but according to the consequences each imagined to follow from them. Thus, Alexander from Alexandria in Egypt affirms in the aforementioned letter that the Father ever was, and thence infers that he thinks necessarily follows that the Son, upon whose account he is called a Father, must have ever been, and yet expressly asserts the Son to be begotten, and that the Father alone is unbegotten. When Arius represents these things to his friend Eusebius, this according to what he accounted the necessary consequences of them, and not as they were really maintained by Alexander. And because he apprehended that the absolute co-eternity of the Son with the Father was inconsistent with the Son's being begotten of him, he says that Alexander held was he was unbegottenly begotten, or begotten and not begotten, thus making his own consequences pass for the bishop's sentiments. I have to tell you, I don't even understand every word of what I'm reading here, but I can tell you that this teaching that they have about begotten and unbegotten is exactly what we call today Jesuitical casuistry and sophistry, right in the beginning. These quarrels, these misunderstandings that they have here in the early church is exactly what is today seen in the church and what is today seen in the world. Casuistry and sophistry. To make easy things, easy understandable things, ununderstandable. That always was their goal. Now, on the other hand, Arius asserted, the sun hath a beginning, and is from none of the things that do exist. Not meaning that he was not from everlasting before the creation had a beginning, or that he was created like other beings absolutely out of nothing, or that like the rest of the creation he was mutable in his nature. Arius expressly declares the contrary in his letter to Eusebius, his intimate friend, from whom he had no reason to conceal his most secret sentiments, and says, quote, "This is what we have and do profess, that the Son is not unbegotten, nor in any manner a part of the unbegotten God, nor from any part of the material world, but by the will and counsel of the Father he existed before all times and ages, perfect God, the only begotten and unchangeable, and that therefore, before he was begotten or formed, he was not, i.e., as he explains himself, there never was a time when he was unbegotten." Unquote. His affirming, therefore, that the Son had a beginning was only saying that he was in the whole of his existence from the Father as the origin and fountains of being of his deity, and not any denial of his being from before all times and ages. And his saying that he was no part of God, nor derived from things that do exist, was not denying his generation from God before all ages, or his being completely God himself, or his being produced after a more excellent manner than the creature, but that he was always from God, so he was different both from him and all other beings, and a sort of middle nature between God and his creatures, whose beginning, as Eusebius of Nicomedia writes to Paulinus, bishop of Tyre, was not only inexplicable by words, I'd say, but unconceivable by the understanding of man and by all other beings superior to man, and who was formed after the most perfect likeness to the nature and the power of God. Unquote. This is the strongest evidence that neither Arius, from which stems Arianism, nor his first friends put the Son upon a level with the creature, but that they were in many respects of the same sentiments with those who condemned them. Thus, Alexander declares the Son to be before all ages. Arius expressly says the same, that he was before all times and ages. Alexander says the Father only is unbegotten. Arius, that there never was a time when the Son was not begotten. Alexander, that the substance of the Son is inexplicable even by angels. Eusebius, that his beginning is inconceivable and inexplicable by man and angels. Alexander, that the Father was always a Father because of the Son. Arius, that the Son was not before he was begotten, i.e., that he was from before all ages the begotten Son of God. Arius again, that the Son was no part of God, nor from anything that did exist. Alexander, that the only begotten nature was a middle nature between an unbegotten Father and things created by him out of nothing. And yet, notwithstanding all these things, when Alexander gives an account to the principles of Arius to the bishop, he represents them in all the consequences he thought fit to draw them to draw from them, and charges him with holding that the sun was made like every other creature absolutely out of nothing, and that therefore his nature was mutable and susceptible equally of virtue and vice, with many other invidious and unscriptural doctrines, which Arius plainly appears not to have maintained or thought. But as this the common fate of the religious disputes to be managed with an intemperate heart, 'tis no wonder that disputants should mistake each other, or in their warmth charge one another with consequences which either they do not see or expressly deny. Whilst this is the case, the controversy can never be fairly managed, nor brought to a friendly and peaceable issue. Many methods were tried, but all in vain, to bring Alexander and Arius to a reconciliation, the emperor himself condescending to become a mediator between them. So, and this is where I stop the reading today. We will continue next time in the reading of the book, The History of the Inquisition, still in the introduction on page 25 in the book. I hope you enjoyed me reading, and of course I know that you will have the understanding that I did not read this part beforehand. This is the very first time that I read everything I read here, so here and there a word is wrongly pronounced and wrongly read. Also because sometimes it is hard to read, as you can see on the screen for yourselves, but I try my best to get us acquainted with the history of the Inquisition, which is so important, because when we are not aware of the history of the Inquisition, we will not be aware of the Inquisition coming back right at us today and in the future, 50 years after the Second Vatican Ecumenical Council, where the Protestants capitulated to the Roman Catholics. As Tony Palmer said, maybe we are all Catholics again. Well, I'm not, but ask yourself that. Ask yourself that. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. Until next time, Jogler 66 from Hour of the Truth says God bless you. Signing off and bye-bye.